night. C4 is not every day. We get to have the governor on to talk, and we've got a lot to talk about. But we are very pleased to be joined now by Governor Larry Hogan. How are you, Governor?
Good, morning,
good to have
Governor.
You on.
Hey, it's great to be with you, Bryan. And that other guy that's on there with you, too. That's C4 guy.
Absolutely. You said it right, Governor.
There you go.
Kudos to you. I like to call this election week because early voting has begun and you can vote every day all the way through November 3rd. I know there's been a lot of talk about the mail-in ballots and that controversy, but how do you think it has gone so far with early voting and the mail-in?
Well, so far, so good. I mean, we're watching it very carefully and in constant contact every day. Our team is to see, make sure that the boards of elections are doing everything they can to ensure that everybody gets a chance to vote and that every vote is counted fairly. But so far, it's been pretty good. I mean, we had high turnout yesterday at a lot of the polls and some lines, but for the most part, you know, they were doing a good job on keeping everybody safe, and people didn't seem to mind waiting a little bit. And we've been messaging to everybody, it's probably best to try to early vote or vote in off-peak times, because we still believe there's going to be large, long lines on election day itself.
Maryland Governor Larry Hogan is on board with us. And Governor, we're going to get to, I know you find it boring now, 73% approval rating again, and 70-some percent, 80%. We'll get to that in a moment, Governor, when it comes to the polling numbers on your performance as governor. But I do want to ask you about something that Bryan and I were talking about. $250 million now you've leveraged using the Rainy Day Fund to help small businesses. But you mentioned as a part of that the fact that local jurisdictions are holding on to millions from the original CARES Act money. Could you amplify that and talk about that? Because if that's the case, I mean, why isn't that money hitting the street?
Well, it's a great question. So our large jurisdictions, the top five counties, got money directly from the feds. This is CARES Act funding, and that's just the way they distributed it across the country. Ones with a certain population level got money directly. So we don't know exactly what's going on with them. We know they have hundreds of millions that they haven't spent. But the other 19 jurisdictions, it passes through the state. And we, you know, provided a lot of flexibility just getting those dollars out to the counties to use as they saw fit in their local areas. And we got reports back a week or so ago showing that nearly two-thirds of the money had not been spent yet. It's a couple hundred million dollars. And we need to get that out where it can do the most good in the community. And it by law, the federal government requires it all be spent by the end of the year. So we're coming down to, 60 days left to get hundreds of millions of dollars out to help people. And there's a lot of people that need help.
Yeah.
And so we're putting some pressure on them, and they're stepping it up. And I saw a few counties just since our announcement that have said that they're getting their money out to help small businesses and help people in need and to spend it on the things that we think is going to help us with our economic recovery.
So what can they spend it on? I mean, that's what people want to know. I mean, there are a lot of businesses that have been hurting for quite some time. They're like, wait a second, you had all of this money and you couldn't have doled it out to any of us. Can they spend it on anything they want, or does it have to go to specific causes?
I mean, we gave them almost complete flexibility, but the CARES Act funding does require that it has something to do with, pandemic and or the economic fallout from the pandemic. They can't just go out and, spend it on other things the county was, deferring or things that they hadn't spent on, and they want to build a new building for their county government, or they want to go back and take care of their deficit, or give unions more money. They can't do any of that. It has to be spent on things that can really help us with the current crisis.
Governor Hogan, according to the Gonzales Research Media and Services poll that's out today, 77% of Marylanders think that the way that you've handled COVID-19 has been positive, and they're going with that. Having said that, we still face the resistance at the local level of some form of hybrid or in-school learning with some of the large jurisdictions, even though you and Superintendent Karen Salmon have called for that. How can we get beyond that, Governor?
Well, it's the way the law, first of all, the poll showed that I think it's 60-something, 63-67% of people either wanted some form of hybrid learning and or in-person instruction, which is what we've been pushing for. You know, we weren't saying every single kid has to get back in every school, but we did want to get as many kids as we could who really needed that in-person instruction back in the classrooms. That's what the state Board of Education voted for. It's what the state superintendent is for. It's what we've been pushing since August. We authorized every single school in the state to be able to open. But state law gives the authority to local governments and to duly elected school boards to be more restrictive than the state. Like, you know, they can't be less restrictive if we put an executive order in statewide, but they can, they do have that power. These are the people that you elected in your various counties, and we've been encouraging them to continue to put pressure on their county councils and on their county executives or county commissioners and their school boards, because overwhelming majorities of people, you know, they want to go about it in a safe way, and they don't want to pack the schools and endanger kids and teachers. But, you know, there's only 27% that want that have the same position as the teachers union about no kids back in school.
So we keep hearing from the teachers union, and you know that I'm on board with this. I've got three kids. I want them in school, and I've been pushing for it for quite some time. So I understand that argument, but they keep on saying that there's not enough PPE. They worry about ventilation. Yet I keep on hearing now that these counties have all of this money that they haven't spent yet at this time. Can A, you tell us that there is enough PPE and that it is safe from your vantage point to send kids back in school? And if they don't have enough money, could you give it to them from the statewide level, or can the county use that money that they got from the CARES Act?
Yes, yes, and yes. They do have plenty of PPE that we have invested hundreds of millions of dollars directly into the schools from CARES Act funding, and their counties have hundreds of millions of dollars that they can help them with, and it's just a smokescreen. I mean, yes, we want to keep our kids safe, but all that stuff about it, you know, they don't have anything that they need is completely false. We now have, as of yesterday, 19 counties who have voted to bring kids back into schools in one way or another. I think we've got 14 counties already with kids back in school, have been in some cases for a month or two. We got more starting next month. I think five more counties bringing kids in. I think a couple of counties are going from where they had 20-some percent to 50% to 80% of the kids back in. And there really are only five counties, and it's the larger jurisdictions, who are just refusing to have kids back for the whole year. And those are the folks that were elected to make those decisions, but we don't agree with them at all.
Governor Larry Hogan is on board with us. And Governor, I've got to turn to the subject that you and I have been talking about since the National Guard left our city in May of 2015, is overwhelming violence in our city. Yesterday morning at 11:30, a man was shot and killed at a gas station in broad daylight, not far, by the way, Governor, from my late Congressman uncle Congressman Perrin J. Mitchell's office, about a block away from where his office used to be. And this is the sixth homicide since Friday amongst about 20 shootings. And it, Governor, it's just, it's overwhelming.
Yeah, it's the thing that I'm most frustrated with out of, you know, being governor for 5.5 years. It's a thing we've been focused on, and we can't get any support from city leaders or from legislators. Look, I said at the beginning of last session for the fifth time before the session started, and in my State of the State address, I said, if you do nothing else in this entire 90-day session, you must pass some laws to do something about the repeat violent offenders, the people that are committing felonies with guns in the city. And we put a crime package together, which passed the Senate miraculously, even though we had no support from the mayor or any of the city council or any of the city leaders. But it failed in the truncated session to pass the House. And there was all this nonsense about, you know, calling it mass incarceration and we shouldn't put anybody in jail. And look, we passed the Justice Reinvestment Act. We've reduced the number of people in prison. We've lowered the sentences. We passed the Second Chance Act. But for repeat violent shooters, there have to be consequences. We have to get them off the streets. We've got to put them in jail. And that's what 90-some percent of the people in Baltimore City believe. It's what 90% of all voters in the state, including all African-American voters, feel in all the polling. It's why you were just talking about the polling numbers that came out. People say, how does a Republican governor have 87% approval rating in the black community? Well, it's because they agree with us that the most important thing is to do something about this violent crime, because they're in many cases the victims of this crime, and they're ruining their neighborhoods, and they don't feel safe in their communities.
Have you reached a point where you say, well, if I'm not going to get any help, and I have 87% support from the African-American community, which means you have a ton of support in Baltimore City itself, from doing something drastic? And that, I mean, a takeover of the city, or putting the National Guard in, or maybe putting state troopers on the streets of Baltimore on a regular basis.
Well, so the city police force is three or four times larger than the state police force, and so we're shorthanded in both of those places. It just makes no sense to put guys that are used to patrolling highways out in rural communities and have them walking the streets of Baltimore. We did call up the National Guard for a short period of time, but you know, I don't think people are ready for martial law and a takeover of the city. But yeah, maybe in the election in 2022, maybe I'll just run for mayor of Baltimore and fix it myself.
You know, you're going to make news on that.
Are you making an announcement, Governor?
I mean, you know, Governor McKeldin did that after two terms. He's the only other Republican to ever be reelected, and then he became mayor for two terms.
Well, Governor Hogan, I must ask you this also, because of some perception that based on some of the things you did as National Association Governor Chair and some of the things the polling numbers show, you are term limited. Are there discussions now about what happens after 2022 with a Governor Hogan, maybe a 2024 look at national politics?
You know, I mean this very sincerely. I love the job I'm in. It's a difficult job, but we've got a great team of people working really hard, and I'm in this job until January of 2023. And that next election is really far off from now, and we got an election to get through here next week. And but look, I wouldn't rule out anything in the future. You know, I could go back to the private sector, which I spent my whole life as a small business guy, or I could, you know, look at something else. But I really haven't given it any thought and don't want to give it any thought at this point in time.
You know, you in this Gonzales poll, you have high numbers, obviously, across the board. But you actually poll higher with Democrats than you do with Republicans. And there are some Republicans who are upset with, you know, some of the lockdowns that took place. Obviously, there's concern of COVID numbers going up. Do you see us going backwards at all when it comes to, you know, any kind of new restrictions in place, depending on what these numbers look like?
Well, look, you know, I ran for office only because I was a frustrated small business owner, and I ran for one reason, and that was to help our small businesses grow, to turn our economy around, put people to work, and that's what we accomplished for almost 6 years, and then this COVID crisis hit. We are doing better economically than almost any state in the country, better than the national numbers, better than 40 states. On our economy, we've got lower unemployment. We've got 100% of our businesses open since August. But the virus is affecting the economy, and people are suffering. but I don't anticipate, you know, going back to some of the measures we took before. I think there's fatigue, but excuse me. But I do believe that, you know, the virus is spiking across the country. We are ready for another wave. Maryland has been one of the few that's kind of avoided that so far, but we don't have any magic, you know, wall that's going to keep the virus out of our state. And we do anticipate it getting worse in the fall, having hospital surge, which is why we built 6,000 new hospital beds. It's going to affect the economy. There's no question about it. Regardless of any actions we may take, people are not going to feel safe going out to large gatherings and entertainment venues and eating inside restaurants. It's just a fact that it has nothing to do with what actions we may take.
Governor Larry Hogan, there is a question one on the ballot which will take away, or at least put it this way, will give the legislature additional powers to move monies around the budget. Right now, for the folks who don't know, the Maryland governor controls where the money is allocated. The legislature can only take away. In normal times, this might look like a good government type of thing, but these things have only happened under your administration, the removal of power from the governor in a variety of ways. Can you speak to that?
Well, I think this is probably, we've had close to 200 bills that take power away from the governor because the legislature is, you know, 70% progressive Democrats in both houses, and they don't like the idea that we have checks and balances. But the voters obviously do like it, which is why they elected me and reelected me overwhelmingly, because even though the state is mostly Democrat, they didn't want a runaway, uncontrolled, unchecked legislature. It's worked really well for over 100 years. It was put in place, the current rules, it worked for every single Democratic governor. It was put in place because they didn't want the legislature to have that much control over the budget. And it was actually put in place when the legislature was about to bankrupt the state, which is the concern I think most people have. So it's a terrible bill. If people believe that the legislature is really the best one to control spending and taxes, and that they should have complete authority, then they should vote for question one. But if they want to see balance and some kind of checks in the system and some type of moderation so that we don't return to the days of, Martin O'Malley and 43 consecutive tax hikes and, you know, tens of billions of dollars in increased spending, then, they got to vote against this thing.
So, you know, we are in election week, and I know you already voted. Do you have any thoughts on how this thing's going to go? You know, what we'll be talking about on November 4th or November 5th?
You know, it's I'm like everybody else. I think it's going to be closer than most people think and what the national media has been talking about. But I couldn't tell you exactly what's going to happen. I think we're all watching. I think we're going to have a record turnout on both sides, people very passionate. It's going to be a long night. Hopefully we'll get a result. My concern is that if it's too close and with all the mail-in voting and that we may not have a final result for a while, which could cause some concern and chaos. But I'm like everybody else, just waiting to see the results.
Real quick, Governor Larry Hogan, today you will be at the dedication ceremony for the Construction Education Academy over in East Baltimore. This is something that I've been working with outside of WBAL as a MC for the Project Jumpstart, which is helping 18, 19, 20-year-olds get skills, Bryan, in terms of the trades so they can actually make a quality living. And, Governor, one of the things I'm raising in that is the fact we really want to turn this violence around. We've got to give young people the skills they need to be independent. Our schools aren't doing it well. This Construction Education Academy is very important.
It really is. I'm very excited to be there. I think we've got six or seven stops in Baltimore today, and I'm very excited to be starting off up there at the ABC Education Academy. And you're right, C4. We think that workforce development, job training, giving people the skills they need to get a productive, well-paying jobs. And that's the way out of poverty and then many of the other issues. And it's been terrific. I mean, we're nationally recognized for our workforce development programs, including for returning citizens and people coming out of jail to give them a second chance and, young people. So this ABC Academy is going to be able to – ABC will be able to double the number of people that they can train up to 5,000 people a year now with this. And it really, the construction industry is booming. We kept it open throughout the entire pandemic, which is one of the reasons why our economy is doing so good comparatively. Many other states completely shut down. But they have a desperate need for people with skills, and there's plenty of jobs out there. I think it's terrific, and thank you for your involvement in the C4.
You know, I like to go out on a happy note, but I did want to ask you this because it just dawned on me. You know, you have an 87% approval rating with African Americans. That's just an astonishing number for any politician. I mean, I don't know if Barack Obama had that high of a number in Maryland. Yet you were called a white supremacist by the head of the Democratic Party in Maryland, Maya Rockmore Cummings. She doubled down on it. I mean, what does that tell you about our politics today, Governor?
Well, it's one of the things that frustrates the heck out of me is the kind of the name calling and divisiveness and angry rhetoric. And I was disgusted by her comments, and it was completely false. And I think it's why she's not in Congress and she's no longer the chair of the Democratic Party. Because I don't think she speaks for 87% of the African Americans or for a majority of Democrats.
That former chief of staff Mitchell needs to work on that 13%, Governor.
You know, I was trying to argue with him about who was responsible for that because it couldn't be me. So it's either your cousin Kiefer, who is the chief of staff, or it's you because you're the first one to ever put me on the radio. So I would say it's the Mitchell family is what's helped a lot with that.
Well, I'm certainly staying out of that one. Great to have you on, Governor.
Bryan had nothing to do with it.
I promise you I didn't. Good to have you on. Thanks very much for your time. We always appreciate you coming on our show.